Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the fourth meeting of the Rural Affairs, Island and Natural Environment Committee in Session 6. Before we begin, can I remind all those committee members using electronic devices to switch them to silent. Before we begin the meeting, I have apologies from Jim Fairley, but can I welcome Emma Harper, who's sitting in as his substitute. Emma, can I invite you to either declare any interests or say that you have no relevant interests to declare?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everybody. I have no interest to declare.
Thank you. Okay, our first item of business is an introductory evidence session on fisheries and aquaculture. And I'd like to welcome remotely to the meeting our first panel of industry stakeholders. So this morning we have Elaine White, the Executive Secretary of Clyde Fishermen's Association, Elspeth MacDonald, Chief Executive Officer for the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, Tavish Scott, Chief Exec of the Scottish Salmon Producers Organisation, and Jimmy Buchan, Chief Exec Officer for the Scottish Seafood Association. So before we move to members' questions, I'd like to first invite our panellists to make a very brief opening remark, and I'm afraid we've only got 1 hour for this session, so politely request that you keep your opening remarks to no more than a few minutes. The advantage of you appearing remotely is that I can turn you off at will, so if you could keep your remarks to a minimum. So first of all, I'd like to invite Elaine White to make an open remark and then move to Elspeth, Tavish, and then last but not least, Jimmy Buchan. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having us here. My name is Elaine White. I am the Executive Secretary of the Clyde Fishermen's Association, which actually has just under 50 boats now. In the last few years, we've lost quite a number of boats, and I think that speaks to what we will be talking about today. I'm also a member of CIFA, which is a national organisation of just over 400 boats. Today, I think the main thing that I want to concentrate really on is capacity, resilience and potential. Because obviously Brexit and COVID have certainly shown some issues in our markets, in our process, in our infrastructure, and our opportunity to fish. So these are the key issues that we would want to focus on going forward.
Thank you very much, Elaine. You've certainly set the bar very high in terms of your opening introduction, so that's great. Can we move on to Elspeth, please?
Good morning, Convener and Committee, and I'm afraid I don't think I'll be able to match Elaine for brevity, but thank you very much for inviting us to take part in today's session. SFF very much welcomes the opportunity to engage with parliamentarians about our industry, and we hope that you will find today's session useful. I don't need to repeat again the turbulence that fishermen have faced in the last 18 months. That's summarised in the briefing document that I've submitted in advance of today's session. And I think what's important today is that we look forward and not back, and we focus on the future challenges and opportunities. And I just want to say up front and very clearly that this industry is about producing food, and not just any food, but healthy, nutritious food with an extremely low carbon footprint, and food that is produced from renewable and sustainable wild fish stocks without the need for high inputs of things like fertilisers or chemicals. Wild-caught Scottish fish have a lower carbon footprint than all other sources of animal protein and indeed many plant-based sources. And I think it's absolutely right that I'm sure we'll be speaking today, that Scotland and the UK are rightly focused on transitioning our economies to net zero. And Scotland is blessed with fishing grounds that are not just highly productive, but are also well managed. And this means we have a great asset on our doorstep in our seas to help us on this pathway to net zero. And we must not lose sight of that. We are concerned by some of the commitments in the cooperation agreement between the Scottish Government and the Scottish Greens, which give the impression of prioritising conservation over climate-smart food production. And SFF is really proud of our track record in working with Scottish Government over the course of many years on the identification, designation and management of marine protected areas. And thus far, the focus has always been about achieving a balance, and we want to see this approach continue based on good evidence, co-design and transparency. And I would also just like to very briefly highlight to the committee the importance of our sector and having space to operate. Scotland's seas are increasingly crowded as the blue economy expands. Offshore renewables will clearly be a major contributor to the energy transition that is needed to achieve net zero, but we must have equitable and effective marine planning that enables coexistence between our industries. So So if Scotland is to become a net zero country with a thriving society and economy for the benefit of all, then we need both of those sectors to succeed. And I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Elspeth. Tavish. Sorry, Tavish, we don't have any sound at the moment.
How does that sound? Is that any better?
That's grand, thank you.
Great. Good morning, Convener. Sorry, Mr. Carson, the idea cut me off before I'd even started. I think it was too much for me. Very welcome with Elspeth to join this committee this morning. An open invitation to you and indeed to all your colleagues to visit a sea farm at any stage that you'd like to learn more about our industry. Very pleased to see parliamentarians from all political persuasions with us at any stage. Just three points to highlight this morning. Firstly, labour challenges for our sector, along with many other sectors in the Scottish economy at this time. We'd welcome, as a sector, a flexible UK-wide immigration policy in addition to the measures we want to instigate as a sector ourselves with our colleagues in education. Secondly, the acute pressure, and you will well appreciate this as a member of a rural constituency, Mr. Carson, on housing in rural areas. Very, very acute issue for our sector in terms of our people and their employment in rural and island Scotland. And finally, on transport, you'll not be surprised to hear me say that the needs of our sector in terms of exports, both bringing product into the central belt of Scotland and then on to export out of Scotland and across the UK is creaking at the moment, and we need some government assistance just on the just to ensure that that transport infrastructure is frankly better than it is at the moment, both in terms of servicing the islands but also in other ways as well. I'm happy to rest at that.
Thank you very much. And finally, Jimmy Buchan, please.
Yes, good morning, convener and committee. Thank you for the opportunity to come and present you guys. SSA is a membership of 80, covers small, medium and large processors and a range of processing within, from shellfish, pelagic to whitefish. So we cover a lot of the seafood. I would just like to start by saying the opportunity to come here and engage with you guys is fantastic. Tavish and I called for a task force way back in January. And it just lets you see what happens when the industry and the politicians of all persuasions and governments come together and work for the collective good. And I would like to put in record the Victoria Prentice, David Jukett, Fergus Ewan and Mary Gugin, who have been at that task force and have delivered well for the industry. So that's great. Exports are continuing to flow daily. Demand is good from our EU customers. It's the politics in between, guys, it's the problem. So we need to get better and smarter at how we work with our EU counterparts, because the demand is there, we've got the product, we need to make sure that we can get that product to our customers. I would also like to just say that it hadn't not been for the Food Standards Scotland and the Environmental Health Officers, along with Seafish and Seafood Scotland, they have done a sterling job, and it should go on record that without all these stakeholders working again collectively, we've managed to get this huge block we had back in January smoothed out a bit, although there is much work to be done. I think that's enough for the moment, but as I say, I'm really happy to be able to engage with you. We need to work together, and we've got so much ground to cover, so I'll be quiet for a moment, and I'm sure I'll get another opportunity to speak. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I very much appreciate your brief introductions, and I'm sure you'll have the opportunity to add a lot more as we go through the questioning. We have got a series of questions. I'm going to kick off looking at the impact of COVID-19 and EU exit on the seafood trade, and we've already heard about the excellent engagement from stakeholders in the Scottish Seafood Export Task Force. And I know that the sort of very small, or what I would appear to be very small issues like a system that didn't know the difference between monkfish cheeks and monkfish tails and whatever, and was able to solve little issues like that, which had big repercussions in the industry. And it's my understanding, Tavish, you played a role in trying to digitise records and such like to streamline the system. That task force has now completed its work and there's a Scottish Seafood Industry Action Group. But can I go to each member in turn and ask how imports and exports are functioning 9 months on and what ongoing and unresolved issues is the new Seafood Industry Action Group likely to have to address? If we start with, Jimmy, we'll start with you.
Thank you once again for getting me to come back so quickly. I think one of the things that I have to say is seafood is now flowing. It's still as much work to be done. The continuation of the new form of a task force is welcome because we're still issues that we need to address. Far be it, we've now just learned in the last 24 hours that the EU will continue to have concessions for incoming imports, but we as an industry will have to continue to endure the imbalance of that on an outward trajectory. So if I could just give you a simplification here. We've got a wagon and a tractor pulling fish. That everything in that wagon, the pallets, the fish, everything has to be certified, approved and stamped going outwards. The wagon then gets to its destination in France. It unloads. Everything is checked. All is good. The same wagon goes to the next pickup station and it picks up goods coming in. There are absolutely no checks and that wagon comes back into the UK seamlessly. That is how unbalanced this whole thing is. And that is where, until we get equality, I think we're going to find it hard to find our EU counterparts to come to the table and find a smoother, more faster way of supplying our seafood. Nonetheless, seafood is actually getting to its destination, but we've just got to overcome these problems. I would like to just lastly very, very quickly highlight this, because this is really important. The key to this is having vets at the hubs to certify the seafood. And the private sector, on its trajectory coming out of the lockdown, can and will pay more for vets if it needs it. And therefore, we've got to make sure, ministers and officials, that we've got something in place that helps us keep retention of these vets in the critical areas of the hubs, because without them, nothing is flowing. So I think that's a really important matter I would like you to note down. Because without, as I say, I can't say it enough, without the vets, the seafood is going nowhere. And we are losing, the public sector is losing out to the private sector hand over fist in this. So I'll finish there. Thank you.
Thank you. Could I move on to Tavish to give the view of the aquaculture industry, please?
Thank you, convener. Just a couple of points to add to Jimmy Buchan's very fair analysis of the situation. Firstly, on the export system into Europe, we do need that digital system to replace the paper-based system that we have at the moment. And if a committee were minded to ask on progress of that, we'd be very grateful, as not just in my sector, but I suspect right across seafood more generally. So that would be very helpful. The other side to it is, as the number one food export business for Scotland, we depend obviously on long-haul air as well, out of Heathrow. To some extent, that market may start to emerge again out of Scotland, but broadly speaking, Heathrow is the hub. And in terms of the Far East and the West Coast of North America, there, as you will well appreciate, not much long-haul been going on right through the COVID period. So that is a development we'll probably see coming back over the next couple of years. But I think all of us who export seafood long-haul into very important and bigger markets have had that market closed down. So your question about the COVID recovery, I think, relates directly to that. We've seen more going into Europe, more product going into Europe, more salmon going into Europe than into the long-haul markets, France being the biggest market for salmon that we have. And the final point I might make, again, for the committee's interest, is just on the HMRC. Their export stats have been inaccurate in terms of salmon over this first 9 months of the period from the 1st of January. And again, if the committee were minded at some stage just to have a look at that, we'd be very grateful for that, because those stats are very important, both for, of course, for Scottish and UK government purposes, but even more so for our sectors. And it's really important now that we're not in the European Union that those export stats are accurate and on time. And that hasn't quite been the case over this period. Thank you.
Thank you. And Elspeth, could you give the perspective of the Fishermen's Federation?
Thank you. Yes, I think Jimmy and Tavish have given a very clear and concise account of the situation that, that we've certainly seen this year. And I think if we turn back the clock last year also and look back at the disruption that the industry suffered as a consequence of COVID, I think maybe the comment I would just make there is that whilst the COVID situation is clearly very much better in the UK and elsewhere in our marketplaces, I think if last year taught us anything, it's that it might be quite hard to predict what might happen in the future and whether there might be some further disruption as a consequence of COVID. And I think what that showed last year was the very high reliance that this industry has on the hospitality sector. And on our obviously very valuable export markets, as have already been discussed. So I think perhaps there's something there that we might need to think about going forward in terms of, you know, how we can perhaps encourage greater domestic consumption of our product and not be so reliant on that hospitality sector, which we have, as we have seen over the last 18 months, has been subject to very significant disruption. Thank you.
Thank you. And Elaine, could you give us an idea how the last 9 months has been for the fishermen actually on the coal face, if you like? It's not a good analogy, but those going out in boats on a day-to-day basis, how has the last 9 months been and how do you see it going forward?
Okay, well, if we could go back further than that and just say that we always saw these problems coming with the market. No, that wasn't a constitutional stance. We were neutral, but we just felt that the market was a major issue when everyone was talking about access to stocks, because that 96%, 86% of our stocks go to the EU. So we always seen that as being an issue. It does us no good to have been right on that fact that we were a Cassandra and pointed out we needed better planning. So in terms of how it's been for the fishermen, absolutely awful, absolutely awful. Things are picking up slightly, but I have fishermen who were still being paid the same for their prawns that they were at the height of the pandemic. So I think the issue that a lot of our members are very concerned about is the buying back into the EU market. Because as things improve, some of the prices, what we're doing is we're buying our way back into markets that we might have lost to Norway or Ireland, etc. So what we're actually doing is we're still keeping the prices extremely low for the smaller fleets. So in terms of the fisherman and money in his pocket, he is still, it might be getting slightly better, but it's still not where it has to be for the resilience of the fleets. The other thing that I am concerned about is what happens with Northern Ireland, because, and that's very much linked to our infrastructure as well. A lot of our prawns, etc., go to Northern Ireland at the moment to be fully processed into Scampi, which is a massive part of some of our fleets. If we continue to have issues, it will really be moved down the line. I can see us having problems. I would very much like us to have more infrastructure this side of the water to make sure that our fleet are secured in terms of processing. But yes, I mean, things are very much improved. Like everybody, I would thank them, all of our politicians for coming together in the cross-party group to try and work through some of these implementation issues. But I do think we have to be very aware that the fishermen at the coal face are still, the resilience is very, very low and their prices are not what we would hope they would be. But I caution that with a sense of the ability to have potential there to look at it better. And if I could just caveat as well, prices and capacity. In terms of people processing, in terms of people sending away, the prices of the increased paperwork and the time it takes to do that paperwork, it is what can be very, very difficult for the small rural communities. And I think we just have to have cognizance of that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to move on to questions on labour. I'll start with Karen, then move on to Mercedes. Karen.
Thank you. I'm glad to hear that there's been some movements forward, however tentative some might be with that. As we're all aware of the news reports of fresh seafood rotten in the back of lorries, you know, fish markets empty and boats tied at the harbour. That was, you know, it was quite upsetting for a lot of people to see. So it's nice to see and hear some positivity going forward there. Jimmy, I know that you've been very vocal as well, and rightly so, on the issues of labour shortages, which is a massive problem here at the North East Coast. But what I really want to get to the bottom of and ask the panel is, you know, we often hear, and I've used this phrase myself, the double whammy of Brexit and COVID. And for the benefit of the committee, can you clarify for us from your perspective exactly what are the Brexit issues, what are the COVID issues? Because I think that's essential to come up with the targeted solutions. And what do you believe should be prioritised really within our gift here in regards to labour shortages and haulage problems? Thank you.
Thank you for that question, Karen. I suppose the two are linked, but yet they're two separate issues, the COVID and the Brexit. So if we take the COVID, we are returning to some sort of new normal, we might say. It's not normal, but it'll be a new normal. And that itself within the workplace creates problems as people are absent from work due to being either having the illness or being in close contact with someone with the illness. So industry is going to continue to limp through this one way or another until either the vaccine overcomes the problem or we find other solutions within the workplace. But that aside, Brexit is creating, I'm not saying it's creating all the problems, because I think this labour shortage was coming to us long before there was COVID, long before there was Brexit, because I have been raising this issue with government and government ministers for over 4 years. So this shortage of labour has been coming, possibly with COVID and Brexit, that has exaggerated and made it a much more frontline problem. However, I would rather look at how do we solve the problems. And the problem can be solved. The government can change the shortage occupation list, which was on the advice of the Migration Advice Committee. It can give concessions to industry. The industry is calling out for labour. Labour seems to be in a shortage, not only in the UK now, but it's now becoming apparent there's shortages in lorry drivers right across Europe. So it appears that it is the sector where people are no longer finding an attractive place to work. And with other job opportunities, and especially with hospitality opening up, better working hours, better working conditions, perhaps that is where people are seeking views. So we're going to continue to have this labour shortage. So in my opinion, we need to either open up to more global workforce of people who we can't pool from, or we find other solutions within the UK workforce or people who are available for work to be put into the areas where the work is. I think that might be a problem. I think here in North East Scotland, where we work and live within a buoyant oil and gas industry, unemployment is relatively low, and we do not have the amount of people, the bodies that we can pool from. So we've either got to get the people into the area, or move the factories to where the people are, or find an alternative solution. And I think that's where we need to sit down, as I've said, both governments, industry stakeholders, and work through these problems and come up with action plans and solutions that can help the industry. Thank you.
Tavish, you've indicated you'd like to come in this.
Yep. Yes, thank you, Convener. I just wanted to support Jimmy Bruchan's point there about the need for a flexible UK immigration policy, because the issue we've had in the processing sector in the salmon industry relates particularly to processing, whether it's in Fort William or in Rosyth, where there is a large Maui processing business. And that is simply about the lack of labour. In many parts of Scotland, there simply aren't the people, as Jimmy rightly says, to attract. And we have done everything as companies to produce better terms and conditions, to improve everything about working in a processing plant. But the labour force simply isn't there. So we would very much and strongly support any work done with the United Kingdom government on a more flexible approach to immigration, because there's no two ways about it. Many people who did work in our processing sector before came from Eastern Europe. They were very valued members both of our businesses but also of our communities, and we would welcome that returning, and anything the committee might wish to do on that we'd be very grateful. Thank you.
Okay, and Elaine would like to make a comment.
Yes, thank you. Just to back up what everyone else has said, but in terms of a lot of the areas where we work, it's very rural, and it's not a case of paying low wages is a case of getting skilled people to come in and do the job. So in terms of labour policy, I would agree that we very much have to do something, because in terms of the catching sector, if we can't catch wild fish, we don't have any processing or anything else onwards from that. So I think it's what we can do to maybe support those people in boats that have left, or the rural areas where we don't have access to workforce that we have to work on as well. So thank you.
Thank you. Can I come to Mercedes for further questions on this topic, then Alistair on a supplementary?
Okay. Thanks, Convener. Thanks to the panel for coming today. Yeah, my question relates to Labour, and particularly off the back of what Jimmy Buckham was saying about the need for a global workforce. Because I've had constituents in the northeast region who've raised concerns with me about the living and working conditions of some workers in the industry, particularly workers coming from international areas, so from the Philippines, for example. So I'm interested to hear from the panel what more you think can be done to protect the rights and well-being of workers locally from Scotland, from Europe and internationally, and as well as what can be done to create decent jobs in local communities as well.
I think this is probably one for you again, Jimmy.
Well, I mean, first of all, I'm quite alarmed that you're saying that there may be issues, and if there are, I'm happy to take this up on a separate issue with you on a case-by-case basis, but I'm not aware of any issues of misuse of our good relations that we have with our international communities. So happy to take that up offline. But I think what we do need, and this is one of the points that I do need, would like to raise, is we need inward investment from the governments with grant assistance and vision that we need to make our workplaces attractive, so that not only we become less dependent on the use of global workers, and that therefore our local nationals, our local people, see it as a good career move, so that. We are now operating in some of our older fish units, which was built 30, 40 years ago, which are far outdated, Ken, for what we would expect in a modern workplace. So we need that inward investment. We need the innovation. And one of the things that I've learned in my short time in this job is that where innovation comes in, I always thought that pushed jobs out, but it doesn't. It allows you to upskill the existing jobs so they become the operators of the innovation. But to get that, it is high investment, and we need the policies and the enthusiasm and the vision of stakeholders and governments to drive that forward, so that we then have got a trailblazing processing industry that people actually want to work in rather than shy away from.
Elspeth, can I bring you on this topic, please?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Certainly, some of the fleet in the northeast is indeed quite reliant on international crew, and there are fairly stringent visa conditions, obviously from the UK-wide immigration system, that constrain and control how that works. In relation to the question asked, I think if there are particular issues that the committee member wishes to take up separately, then very happy to do that, as Jimmy suggested. But I think certainly there's a lot of work going on in the industry to try and make sure that wherever you are from, if you're working in the fishing industry, that your rights are protected. We have something called the Fishermen's Welfare Alliance that is a network of industry bodies trying to make sure that we've got the right measures in place, that the industry is compliant with the International Labour Organization requirements on fishing crew. So there's a lot going on within the industry. As I say, there are certain visa conditions that limit what international crew are actually able to do when they're working in the UK. But if there are particular cases that the committee member would like to talk about, then please do get in touch with us separately. Thank you.
Thank you. And can I bring in Alistair for a supplementary, please?
Thank you very much. Notwithstanding everything that people have said about the need to invest in the future and a homegrown workforce. I'm taking it that the panel would agree that there is an urgent situation that requires the availability of visas on an emergency basis. And so I'm keen to know whether people like Tavish or Elaine or the others would support the UK government taking such a measure. And the other related issue is that in many areas, as you'll be familiar, as the panel will know, and especially in island areas, there are some sectors who are simply struggling to find a workforce at all, and that has implications for what we do, how we work together on issues like housing as well. That we will not have a workforce, wherever they're from, if there is nowhere for them to live.
Tavish, I think you touched on that.
Yes, can I agree with Dr. Allen's assessment of that situation? He won't be surprised to know that I'm in Lerwick today, and exactly those issues we were discussing just an hour ago before this meeting started. So I absolutely endorse the point he makes with regard to any measure the UK government could look at in the context of UK immigration policy. Flexibility is what we need, I think, as we've all argued this morning to the committee, and we would be very supportive of any work that Parliament would wish to do in that area to seek to find a system that would give us just a little more, flexibility is, I suppose, the simple word there. And on Dr. Allen's point about housing, very much endorse that. It is a significant issue for the salmon farming sector now in every part of Scotland, particularly acute in the islands. And also, if it's one of the other sides to COVID, what we've seen, and certainly in my home in Shetland, is actually increases in pressure on housing because people have sought to leave, as it were, the mainland of the United Kingdom, if I can put it that way, and find property and housing in our parts of the world. And that has increased housing pressure, and therefore there's less available for young families, young people, working folk who are employed, for example, in the salmon farming sector. So one of the, I suppose you might say, the downsides to COVID and to the whole really difficult period we've been through as a country and in terms of the economy has been that increased pressure on house prices in rural areas. Very difficult for all of us, and certainly in the salmon farming sector that would be the case. So we've worked really hard on that to put money into development trusts, to housing initiatives in the areas in which we farm. We'll do more of that in the future, whether it's on islands or on the west coast of Scotland, but I would be very keen to work with housing associations and other providers on any solutions, frankly, Dr. Allen, that could assist us in providing more housing for your constituents and indeed people who live broadly in the rural highlands and islands.
Thank you. Can I bring in Elaine briefly?
Yes, thank you very much. Just to agree with the points that Tavish has made, just to say I always favour the Danish system, which actually looked to get new people in from the local areas and repopulate from the domestic population, but also the Norwegian system, which in the north of the country takes on over 60% of usually Russian or Eastern European workers if required, but that is not a national policy everywhere else. So I think you have to look at the depopulation issues we have in certain areas, particularly in the west of Scotland, and try and marry them up. And what I am very worried about is that maybe that is being conducted in silos. We have to marry that up with how we're making marine policy, because sometimes if depopulation is as much of an issue as other issues that are being made in different policy spheres, we have to balance them against each other as well. So I absolutely completely agree with them with a visa system which is resilient and works with the local areas. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Elaine. I'm now going to move to Beatrice, who's got some questions on landings and vessel tracking.
My first question is actually around the interaction between the future fisheries management strategy that was published at the end of last year and the programme for government's commitment to deliver a step change in marine protection. So I just wondered if I could get the panel's thoughts on potential trade-offs between the two. I know, Elspeth, you touched on that in your opening remarks.
Elspeth?
That question. I think that's going to be a really key challenge as we move forward in this parliamentary term. I mean, the future of fisheries management document was published by the Scottish Government, I think, towards the end of 2020. There had been quite detailed consultation in the development of that strategy, which took place, I think, during 2019. So strategy publication in 2020 set out the government's direction. And now, of course, we see with the cooperation agreement between the Green Party and the Scottish Greens and the government, a rather different complexion, if you like, in terms of the, as you say, the step change on marine conservation. Certainly a lot of additional things in that cooperation agreement that were not envisaged in the future fisheries management strategy. So I mean, I think clearly there's a lot still to be discussed, obviously, between government and industry and stakeholders in terms of what the priorities are going to be and just how these respective programmes of work are going to go forward. But I think the key element from our sector's perspective is making sure that the right balance is found. As I said in my opening remarks, you know, we have a successful industry here producing a climate smart foodstuff. If we are to be constrained in how we do that, then there has to be considerations of the implications of that, not just on the fleet, but actually do you then have to fill that protein gap, if you like, with food from other sources that perhaps are worse for the environment or have higher emissions, for example. So I think, and I made this point also in my opening comments, we've had a really good track record in the industry of working with the government on marine conservation. We've been very involved in the development, the identification and the designation of marine protected areas, and that has been a really cooperative and constructive process. There's been a lot of trust built up between the government and the industry in doing that, and I think it's been a very effective one. And it's one where the focus has been about achieving the right balance between conservation objectives and economic objectives. And I think going forward in the next stage of work that's to be done on the marine protected areas in terms of the management measures, and then the new work on developing these highly protected marine areas, which are to cover at least 10% of Scotland's seas, then it's really important that government and industry work very closely together in the same transparent, trusted, collaborative way. And I think very important that an evidence-based approach is very clearly taken to that. So, There's a lot to do, I think, in terms of now working through with government how these priorities are going to play out, because there were a number of priorities in the Future of Fisheries Management Strategy, and we now have a number of new priorities from the Programme for Government. There is only so much resource to take these priorities forward, so there's much to do in terms of understanding the priorities of those, but then there will be a great deal to do in that consultative and collaborative approach as we go forward, because I think it would be a great tragedy, actually, if we're to lose the trust and confidence and collaboration that we've had thus far.
Thank you. Beatrice, for any further?
Yeah, please. I just wondered if Jimmy had any comments on that.
I can only support what Elspeth has kind of said before us, because although we're not directly involved in the catching of the fish, I suppose we do have a duty to market the fish, and therefore fish that is coming from sustainable sources and is being harvested in a responsible manner, we do support. So it is kind of important for our marketing arm of our industry that we are aligned with this, but our direct involvement is I like to say, is limited. But if I were to add anything to that, is that I do think that we need to be doing more for our own marketing arm from these fisheries, and I think we've got to get more people eating more seafood. And therefore, the confidence for people to do so comes from that particular side of how the fish is harvested and managed. So we do support it, but we're not directly involved with it. Thank you.
Thank you.
I've got one more question. Or
yeah, if you've got a brief question, yes, thanks.
Well, it's if I could turn to Elspeth again, it's about the future catching policy. And I noticed in your submission you were referring to the ISIS advice and particularly referencing the North Sea cod, and which we hear locally that there's plenty of cod in the sea, but the scientific evidence doesn't seem to agree with that. So I just wondered if you wanted to expand on the point you were making in your submission.
Certainly. I think if for context, it might be helpful for the committee to understand that over the last 2 years, the ICES catch advice for North Sea cod has reduced somewhere in the region of about 80%, which is massive. You know, so it had a huge impact on whitefish fleets in Scotland. And also, I think for context for the committee to understand, the scientific modelling work that underpins the advice that comes from ICES, the catch advice, is based on a model of the whole of the North Sea. Now, it's become very evident over the last 20 years or so that species are on the move, probably in relation to climate change. And that there's a very noticeable northward movement of many species as temperatures, be it land or at sea, warm. So we certainly are seeing a situation now where the North Sea cod population is migrating north, which is why we still see a lot of cod in Scottish waters. But the model for the ICES that underpins the ICES advice for North Sea cod is based on the whole of the North Sea. So the situation we find ourselves now is we have a model that is recommending significant cuts to North Sea cod, but yet in Scotland we have abundant North Sea cod in our waters. So what we are really keen to try to push both governments for, and we've certainly been discussing this with both governments, is for there to be some independent sense check of that ICES advice. It comes from one source. It's not subject to independent challenge. And we have also been in many discussions with both governments again about how we can work with ICES to actually change that North Sea cod model and for it to reflect the fact that that we have a northward migration of fish stocks. But that will take some time to do. And in the meantime, it's really important that we have some independent challenge and sense check of that ICES advice to say, you know, actually, does this look right? Does this reflect what fishermen are seeing at sea every day? Because at the moment, it doesn't. Thank you.
Thank you. Members, I'm very conscious of the time limitation, so I'm going to move on to regulation and salmon farming and questions from Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you. So the panel will be aware that in the previous parliamentary session there were inquiries on salmon farming, and we also had a report last year from the Salmon Interactions Working Group, which highlighted the challenges in the sector and the need to improve efficiency and regulatory change to meet those environmental objectives that were highlighted. So my question initially is, how will members of the panel, and I presume it will be Tavish Scott who will start off with this, will move beyond the status quo and ensure that the current regulatory framework is efficient and it is as effective as it can be?
Tavish.
Thank you, convener. So two very obvious points on that. Firstly, and I think we made this point in our submission to the committee at the tail end of last week, we responded very fully to all the committee reports produced in the last session of Parliament. There is a considerable weight of evidence in those submissions, and I'm sure members have had a chance to peruse those submissions, and they illustrate all the progress we've made across all the recommendations that previous committees of this Parliament have made. The second observation is that, as I noticed, the committee was asking the Cabinet Secretary last week, Professor Russell Griggs has been appointed, indeed, to review the regulatory system in Scotland. We strongly support and endorse that appointment, and also the work he's now doing, both with our sector and our individual companies, and also with many other interests across the salmon farming sector. I know, having asked him, that he plans to speak to a great variety of people in drawing his recommendations together, which he plans to make, as I understand it, later in the year. And that will obviously then be a report that government will consider and decide how to take forward. Our principle there is very simple. We don't want less regulation. We want better and more streamlined regulation. And that, I think, is in the interest both of the marine environment and also in the interests of a sustainable aquaculture industry going forward. One, I may say that the current government, I'm pleased to say, entirely support. And indeed, I think one of the parliamentary questions that was just answered to Rachel Hamilton absolutely made that point. So I think we're very comfortable with that territory, and we believe it's moving in a positive direction, both for all the people who work in our sector, 3,000 people across the member companies and another 10,000 in our supply chain. But the other point, just on the interactions group, the wild salmon interactions group, what that, of course, noted is that there are 12 pressures on wild fish. And what we've asked the government to do in publishing their response, which I understand is due in the next month or so, is to make clear what progress has been made on all those pressures on the wild fish. And that's an agenda I share with Anna Wells at Fisheries Management Scotland and with many other people who work in the wild fish sector. That's an agreed piece of work. We want to see and understand the science and the evidence behind that. And I hope that Rachel Hamilton might endorse that approach, which is based on science and understanding, rather than possibly on some of the rhetoric which floats around in this particular area.
Thank you. Can I move on to questions from Jenny now, please, on the same topic?
Hi. Thank you, panel, for coming along. Scotland and salmon farming are synonymous, I think, and I'm interested to hear more about the innovative work that is happening. I believe about 75% of the supply chain is in Scotland, but also how this work impacts on the environmental side of things, so how you're reducing the environmental impact of salmon fishing. Thank you.
Yeah, Tavish.
Thank you. Sorry for the delay. I was just waiting for my microphone to be operative there. Look, great question. Jenny Minto is very knowledgeable about this sector, and we appreciate her interest in the sector. And yes, on innovation, what I think is fascinating about our supply chain and its weight and range right across Scotland, and there is not a constituency in Parliament that does not have part of the salmon farming supply chain in it, is that it is driving innovation. It is driving new ways of adapting to the circumstances we're in, looking for sustainable solutions. And that comes from a headline document we produced last year, a sustainability charter aimed at making our sector net zero in greenhouse gas emissions, in line with government and in line with the United Nations requirements placed upon all of us, both as citizens and as of companies. And we will play a very active role in driving that forward. And that's where I think the market will come up with solutions, because many of our supply chain work not just in Scotland, but they also work as Scottish companies in international places too. And they are building on expertise and learnings from, for example, Norway and Faroe in providing more environmentally appropriate solutions for Scotland. So this is an exciting world. We're very, very pleased that it's developing at such a rate. And I suspect that here it is one where politicians at government level setting out big targets around, for example, those greenhouse gas emission targets are helpful for industrial sectors, because they make us focus on what we must do. Practical example, yesterday I was up in Ewe Sound and then very north of Shetland, looking at the vessels that take crews out to salmon farms, and also the generators that are on our barges, sort of how in terms of how our fish are fed. All those are now being looked at in the context of more of renewable sources, of battery power, of other ways in which we produce power so as to reduce our emissions. And that will happen right across the sector from the very far south of Scotland right up to Unst in the north. So those kind of innovations are happening. They're happening at pace. And I believe that when we as a sector publish an annual report, a very transparent annual report into our sustainability charter, we'll be able to provide Jenny Minto and colleagues with lots of evidence as to what we're doing and how much more we want to do in the future to be truly a sustainable industry going forward into the next decade.
Thank you. I've now got a very short supplementary from Emma Harper.
It's actually not for right now. It was just to say I can come in after Alistair Allen.
That's grand. OK, could I ask Ariane for her questions on climate and ecological crisis, please?
Thank you, convener. Yeah, so, thank you, panel, for coming today. It's very good to hear, the challenges you're faced with. And I'd be interested to hear a bit about your approach for the climate and ecological crisis. So, as we know, Scotland seas play a key role in the climate by storing carbon, but they're susceptible to a number of threats to our activity. And what I'm aware of is that some of the activity is bottom contact and midwater fishing as being the most geographically widespread and direct pressure on our marine environment, and that commercial fishing also contributes to greenhouse gas emissions, although I heard in introductions from some of the panels that that's maybe less so the case. So we're looking at impacts of ocean acidification, sea level rise, and the changing ecology, which we kind of heard from Elspeth about the fish moving further north. I mean, I think what I just want to say is from the outset, I'm looking for a long-term future for fishing. And so it's about, how do we look at what we're doing right now, which is overfishing, and move to a more sustainable practice. So I'd love to hear from the panel about the kinds of the views that you have on what a just transition would mean for the fishing industry and the coastal communities. And if I start with Elaine.
Thank you. Yes, of course, that this is a concern. It's a change more than anything else that we have to be responsive to. And I guess my first thought would be that we need to look at science. That's what we have to be doing, and we have to be doing more scientific research, particularly I feel in the inshore, not only on the environment, on the seabed, the sediment, various things like that, but also on the stocks, because while we're talking about cod moving north, we're also seeing things like skate and spur dog moving into areas in greater numbers as well. So we have to have responsive science. I would say one of the things that we need to do is get our government working in a reference style fleet with our fishing industry so that we can see where there may be problems and where there may be opportunities to have a sustainable fishing fleet as well. In terms of a just transition, I know that several fishermen have spoken to this about me, and it does feel like something they're on the periphery of. And we need to be a little bit more engaged in it, because I think if something is done to people, they don't tend to like it. They like to be involved in it. So I would agree that. But what I do think is, with the climate and with everything else that we're talking about, we can't be making decisions in silos. We need to be thinking about what's happening with the local communities, how they're sustainable, how the environment's sustainable, everything in the whole. Because just going back to what Elspeth was talking about, the MPA process and the PMF process, that actually probably keeps us awake more than anything else, not because we don't want to protect those features, we absolutely do, but it's getting that balance right and getting the science right to know that we actually are doing something that isn't going to harm communities or is going to allow sustainable development to continue. Because right now, I went through the MPA process, we didn't have as good an experience as Elspeth can recall. I was there and in our regional area, it did lose trust of fishermen. So whatever we do, we have to take them with us. Any good fisherman should be an environmentalist. And I think that's the key thing. And in terms of licensing, that's another thing that we really have to be looking at, because the marine space is becoming multi-use. It's not just fishing, there's various other things. We put quite a focus on the impacts of fishing. We aren't talking about renewables. We aren't talking about different types of marine activity like cable laying, etc. And I think we have to be looking at that licensing in the whole as well and going forward to make sure that we're doing the right thing for the environment. Thanks.
Thank you. Can I get Elspeth to respond, please?
Thank you. I was delighted to hear the committee member say that she was looking for a long-term future for fishing, because that's absolutely what we are looking for too. And I think if I could just make an observation, I've been in this role just over 2 years, and I think one thing that struck me very early on in this job was just how many family businesses, how many generations of families are in this industry. You know, this is not an industry that people come into for the short term. It's an industry that people are and families have been invested in for generations. And nobody has a greater need for this industry to have a sustainable future than the industry itself. I would just like to also maybe just respond to the point about overfishing. I think there were some interesting statistics that were published by the University of Highlands and Islands in Shetland recently, showing that whitefish biomass in Scottish waters are actually a record high in modern times. So I think it's really important to recognise that whilst there certainly has been overfishing historically in our waters, the situation is very significantly improved, and I think that comes down to having good management and good collaboration between government and industry. But I absolutely echo Elaine's point about having robust and better science. I think so much of what we are doing is underpinned by science, so we have to make sure that science is good and is up to date. And is absolutely robust and subject to challenge. I think again, if we think about the contribution that the fishing fleet makes to greenhouse gas emissions, I think the figure for the UK fleet is somewhere in the region of 0.17% of the UK total, which I think you know, really is very small when you compare it to other sectors. Farming, for example, 11%. Transport 25%. The emissions from this industry are really relatively small. That's not to say we are complacent about the fact that we're in a fairly good place. There are clearly more things that we can do, and there are more things that we will be doing. I think it's really important to understand that one of the ways in which obviously, one of the biggest contributor that the fishing industry makes in terms of emissions is through the use of fuel, because our vessels obviously have to be powered to go and catch fish. But fishing for healthy and abundant stocks is really the most fuel efficient way to do it. So the fact that we have healthy and abundant stocks in most of our cases is an efficient way for us to fish. And it's clearly obviously going to be better in terms of emissions too. But we're always looking at how we can reduce our fuel costs and therefore reduce our emissions. There is work that the industry has done over many years, and you see that if you look at the way that fishing vessels have changed the shape and the dynamics of them over the years to make them more fuel efficient. There's a lot of work that has been done and will continue to be done in terms of design of fishing gear to minimise its impact both on the seabed and also to therefore make it more fuel efficient to use. And I think to, you know, we have to look at innovation. We look at the announcement recently from the UK government about the hydrogen strategy. It's very promising to see that marine is included in that strategy and that fishing vessels will be part of that. You know, these are all ways that we need to be looking at innovative ways forward. And also we need to think a bit about investment. I think Tavish mentioned a moment ago, looking at what the fish farming industry could do around things like generators. That's exactly the same sort of challenge that we face in our industry. If we can look at investment into port facilities that, for example, can use shore-based power from renewable sources, then that reduces the reliance that vessels have on using their generators when they're in port. So there's much to do. There's by no means is the industry complacent, but I think the industry starts from a good place, and we will continue to go forward in that manner. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I ask Mercedes for questions on this topic, please?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. As has already been said, we're facing a climate and ecological emergency, and we've heard about the importance of blue carbon and also about the damage that's being done by some parts of the fishing industry to our marine environment. So I wanted to know if the panel thinks there's any sections of the fishing industry that are incompatible with Scotland's ambitious targets.
Could I possibly start with Jimmy on the processing side and then move to Elspeth?
I think that's a difficult question for me, representing a processing sector, to answer, because we're not directly involved in the fishing. I can only say from my experiences 40 years plus as a fisherman and 30 plus years as a skipper, I couldn't continue to go back to the same areas year after year after year and make a fishing vessel profitable if we weren't doing it in a sustainable and responsible manner. So And I can only echo that. That's what all of my colleagues was doing. So I think it's probably better for Elspeth to report on that. But that's my own observation and one I stand by. Thank you.
OK, if we go to Elspeth and then Elaine, please.
Thank you, convener. Jimmy makes a really important point there. I think it's important, again, to understand context. Fishing vessels don't fish everywhere. They fish in areas which are known to be productive and, as Jimmy said, have continued to be productive over many years. And I think that, again, is indicative of effective management. If I can perhaps mention the scalloping sector as an example, there has been much criticism of the scallop sector for having an impact on the seabed. I mean, most means of producing food have some sort of environmental impact. I think looking at our farmers ploughing fields, we see an impact there. So clearly, any type of food production has some kind of impact on the environment. If we think about scallop dredging, for example, I believe Marine Scotland's own figures show that around, I think, 15% of Scotland's inshore waters are subject to scallop fishing, which then suggests that 85% of them are not. And when we look, I think, at the cooperation agreement between the Scottish Greens and the SNP, and we see some very draconian measures being proposed for our inshore waters. I think a challenge back to that document and to that agreement is, where is the evidence for suggesting that we need such an approach? And I think, in fairness, the document recognises that further measures would only be taken where evidence would come to light that they were necessary. But as I spoke about earlier, we already have a robust, constructive process around marine protected areas, priority marine features, which has been effective at identifying the right things and the right places to protect and then taking the measures to do that. So I think making some blanket provision to say that you must, you must have a more blanket sweeping provision for protection, where actually there isn't the evidence to suggest that, is not the right way to go. Let's go forward on the basis of evidence, on the basis of constructive, collaborative discussion. And I think let us recognise that all means of producing food have some impact on the environment.
And briefly, Elaine, please.
Yes, I think this is one of the things that concerns us most. For me, it goes back to process and science. I don't think there's one good way of fishing and one bad way of fishing necessarily. It's about good management. Because if you have too much, I represent Keelmen, I represent Mobile Fishermen, Line and Dive. They all work together and through CIFA, a national body. And they appreciate that if you do too much of any one of those things, you're going to have a problem. What I do think that we have to do is concentrate a lot more on the inshore in terms of science, looking at the stocks and looking at the seabed, looking at what's out there. And as I said, not make policy in silos separate to what's going on socioeconomically as well, because that's really important. I think, I am concerned that we are not going to follow process. For instance, right now we have a lot of really great wild oyster projects that are happening where they're placing wild oysters all over Scotland, which seems a fantastic thing to do. However, I worry very much that this is being used as a type of closing off areas to local fishermen who are maybe fishing sustainably in a different area because it's a PMF. Now, these types of things we have to be aware of. We have to be making decisions based on what we need for the environment, and we also have to be making decisions on process so that nothing is going through the back door or is being used as a secret fisheries management tool. It has to be something we're all sitting down and discussing it fairly. And I would far rather see us talking through process and frameworks than managing things by campaigns, because in honesty, there's no one good way of fishing and no one bad way. It's down to the management of what's appropriate for each of those areas. And that's why blanket policies just do not work and could be quite harmful, actually, to not only the environment, but local communities as well.
Thank you, Elaine. Can we move on to Jenny now, please?
Hi, thanks again. I'm just going to ask a really short question so we hear more from the panellists. I'm interested to know what the priorities, your priorities are for post-EU exit fishery policy, specifically around the objects such as national benefit objective and climate change objective, and also priorities that you have in the development of joint fisheries statements and fisheries management plans. Perhaps if I could come to Elspeth first.
Yeah, certainly. There's quite a lot in that short question, and I think it's really good that the committee has given some focus around the essentially what is the Fisheries Act, which is now our overarching piece of fisheries legislation in the UK, now that the UK has left the EU. I think, again, as I set out in some of my introductory, actually in my background statement that I submitted in advance, certainly, we see as a priority for the new fisheries regime in the UK around really looking at the scope that we have now to develop our own fisheries management regulations. As I'm sure you will all know, the fishing industry was very hugely disappointed by the details of the Brexit deal in terms of the settlement. That we certainly want to see what scope there is to leverage a better settlement going forward to be used and to developed, but I think one of the few advantages that we see in the fisheries heading is that we now have this regulatory autonomy, this ability to determine our own rules in our own waters, and I think that is a real opportunity for the UK and indeed for Scotland, because this is devolved territory, to really look at what are the right types of fisheries management for Scotland in our waters. And I think that also touches on the point that Elaine has just made, that if we have good management, we will have good fisheries. So very much a priority for us around these fisheries management plans, around the joint fisheries statement, will be how the administrations will be working to develop effective fisheries management for Scotland and for other parts of the UK, obviously, and how these will contribute to these overarching objectives of the Fisheries Act, which are around, as you identified, things like how we meet the climate change objectives. And I think some of the things that we've touched on this morning talk about that. So I think there's some real opportunities through the Fisheries Act, Joint Fisheries Statement and the Fisheries Management Plans. And we're very much looking forward to engaging with both the Scottish Government and the UK Government to really make sure that we can maximise the advantages that these bring and make sure that that gives us sustainable fisheries. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Can I just ask a wee supplementary there? I believe the funding package is between 2 to 3 years under the new legislation, whereas I think Europe was up to 7 years. Is that going to impact on the industry? Elspeth.
I think what we have at the moment is a commitment from the UK government for a £100 million fund. And we've started to see some of the details of that emerge fairly recently. And some of that is around innovation and science, and there's more detail to come. So that's just starting to emerge now. In terms of the Marine Fund Scotland, that fund was initially launched only for 1 year. And I think that reflects where both governments are in terms of spending reviews and having single year settlements. And that does make it difficult both for governments, but also for businesses that might want to apply for these funds. Because you can't look at long-term projects, long-term investments on an annual cycle. So I think the sooner that the UK and Scotland can get back into more multi-year funding settlements, then I think the more helpful that will be. Because I've heard quite a lot of people say that they felt that they couldn't take advantage of the Marine Fund Scotland this year because it required expenditure to happen before the end of the financial year. So certainly for longer term investment and planning, we certainly need some longer term funding programmes.
Thank you. Can I move on to Emma now or is Jimmy wanting in? No, he's got an itchy ear. Is he wanting in? Jimmy, go for it.
Yes, it was just to add to that from an onshore point of view. Good management in the fisheries leads to good marketing and which will hopefully drive profitability back into the sector. So it's really good that the management, the science, everything ties up at the catching end, because we can then replicate that through the marketing of the seafood, because it's really important. On funding, funding will drive profitability back into all businesses. And I can give you a classic example where I had a trawler that it was old, it was inefficient, and I was able to attract funding, to draw down funding, to reinvest in that trawler and reduce its carbon footprint by over 33%. And I think one of the things I would like this panel to take away from here is the investment will pay back not only to drive profitability into businesses, but it will help us meet our carbon reduction and our targets going forward in the long term. So although it's an upfront investment, it's a long-term investment for the greater good of the environment. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. I'm now going to move to Emma Harper for some questions on inshore fisheries.
Thanks, Convener. I realise we are going to be challenged for time, so it might be that your responses can be down the line, either written or in future sessions. It's particularly for Elaine White, it's issues of local management and governance of inshore fisheries. I know in the West Coast it's a lot of smaller boats. People need to be more connected. There needs to be more connection with the communities as well. And particularly, you mentioned in the south, in the southwest part, in the Irish Sea. So there's Isle of Man waters, there's English waters, there's Solway Firth, and then Irish Sea waters. So there's all this in the mix, and it must be quite challenging then to manage inshore fishery aspects of these waters, and now we've got a border in the Irish Sea. So it'll be interesting to hear about what should be done, what could be done, what items should we be thinking about in the future.
Thank you very much. I keep going back to management. We have IFGs, which is a very strong way that we can bring our local fishers together to actually come up with plans that suit them. And of course, they don't work in silos. They will be working with their other colleagues in various other Scottish IFGs. So if you're working in the West Coast, you will be talking to the East Coast, etc., about what, because obviously if you make a policy one place, it could actually displace somewhere else. I do think we have to be more reflexive, because I do think, for instance, the Isle of Man make their own policies that works very well, but they don't have reciprocal ones for Scotland. So, it can mean that our fishers are quite disadvantaged. And that's also happened between Northern Ireland and Scotland. So we do have to get that right. I agree. I think capacity is a major issue. I think for a couple of reasons, because we're pulled in so many directions at the moment. You'll have seen the marine planning what happened with the parliamentary review there, and we've got a lot of work to go there. I mean, I think that there's a lot of issues that we actually have to have transparency of process, and we have to have stick to process and know what we're trying to do, as opposed to overshooting into other areas. In terms of the joint fisheries statement, that should go quite a while away to actually working with our neighbours, as should the future fisheries management, to outline what our intentions are. And what I am concerned about is additional things that we probably aren't thinking about, like cumulative impacts, how they can cause displacement. For instance, if we're going to have renewables in the West Coast, how is that going to affect our fisheries? So these types of things, I don't think we're quite there when it comes to local. We need a strength of IFGs, we need resource to do that, we need capacity of our fishermen to engage, and there's quite a lot coming at us at the moment. I genuinely think we need to engage our fishermen a lot more. It's when it comes to the joint fisheries management as well, sorry, just to go back, we need to be aware that a lot of our fishermen are coming to the table for the first time. As CIFA, we are coming to the table for the first time to strategic meetings. So when it comes to things like annual negotiations and quota or space sharing, those types of things, we are new. We're the smaller guys and we're new. There's no reason that we always have to stay that way. But I think it's really important that we do know, and that's, we're fully supportive of the Northeast industry, etc., doing well, and the bigger fleets doing well. But we really need a little bit more attention to the smaller guys for their first engagement in these strategic issues.
Thank you very much, Elaine. Unfortunately, I regret to say we're going to have to bring this session to a close. There is so much more to cover and a lot more answers or questions we'd like to ask. But can I thank you very much for your involvement in the panel today. It certainly set the scene for the work we've got to do in the future. We are now going to take a 5-minute break, and our second panel will go straight to questioning rather than have opening statements. So we'll restart the session at 11:20. Thank you. Okay, welcome back, everybody, and I welcome to the meeting our second panel. We've got Katie Gillam, Head of Marine Ecosystems, and Cathy Tilbrook, Head of Sustainable Coasts and Seas from Nature Scot, Callum Duncan, Head of Conservation Scotland Marine Conservation Society, and Charles Miller, Executive Director for Sustainable Inshore Fisheries Trust. My apologies, I'm not going to ask you for introductions. We're going to go straight into questions, which will give you the opportunity to put across your views. My first question is on the scientific evidence of and the health of and the main pressures on our marine environment. We heard in the last session about the apparent increase in whitefish biomass, a significantly improved collaboration leading to improved health in our seas, comments on the fishing industry, the scallop industry only actually fishing 85% of our waters. We need more information about the scientific evidence. So can I have your comments, and can I start with Callum Duncan, please?
Thank you, convener. I think the evidence base shows that on a whole range of metrics, we've failed to ensure our seas are in good environmental status by 2020. In the global context for that, we have the BEST report in 2019 that talks about the unprecedented decline in nature globally and nothing short of transformative change needed and how we operate as a society to ensure the halting and reversal of the decline of nature. And in marine systems, that report was highlighting fishing as the, along with climate change, the principal driver of that decline of nature at sea. If we bring that closer to home, the collective evidence base of all the UK administrations through the marine strategy process concluded that 11 of 15 indicators were failed. Indicators of good environmental status had been failed by 2020. That includes seafloor condition, that includes many commercial fish stocks, including most shellfish stocks, and declines and concerns about seabirds, seals. Scotland's Marine Assessment 2020 again highlights the concern about the widespread pressure impact from fishing, and that it's present in all Scottish marine regions and offshore marine regions as a pressure. Now, none of this is to say that shouldn't be happening. It's about managing it sustainably and having an ecosystem-based approach to managing fishing. And I think there's a real false dichotomy here, because it's often sort of presented as, you can have conservation or you can have fishing. And obviously we need good conservation with a step change in recovery of the health of our ocean as the prerequisite for a healthy and sustainable fishing industry. And I think some of the comments in the first panel illustrated that we really need to get onto the same page of what the evidence base is, because the statement about 15% of the sea is scallop dredged. The important question we should be asking is how much of the seabed is actually ground that scallops live on, and then we're talking about a percentage of that. So there was a report by Marine Scotland Science that showed that less than 1% of the historically trawled inshore seabed, the inshore seabed of Scotland, was actually protected within marine protected areas. So, I think the evidence base shows there's a lot of cause for concern. We do need that step change in conservation and ocean recovery. We all need to take that journey together. And we absolutely do need to have the conversation about what the just transition for fishing industry, along with all other industries, because all industries have their part to play in securing net zero future. So it's not about singling out fishing; it's one amongst many. It just so happens it's a very widespread impact on the health of our seas.
Okay, thank you. Can I ask Charles to respond, please?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for inviting me to the session as well. I go along with a lot of what Callum's just said. I think there's another sort of interesting sort of detail in what we'd heard earlier around biomass being large, but actually when you sort of dig down a bit further, what becomes apparent is that you've actually got a different kind of makeup of the biomass to what used to be the case. And so certainly recent studies have shown in the West that whilst biomass may be at an all-time high in some areas, what you're seeing is a completely different constituency. So you're seeing a very large number of very small fish, and you're not seeing the large fish. So that's a problem for the ecosystem, but it's also a problem for the fishery. I mean, the kind of large fecund fish like cod are in extremely low numbers, but what you're seeing is huge numbers of very small whiting. And so the evidence needs to be really drilled down into. And so some headline statements can sort of look good, sound good, but when you start to kind of crunch the numbers, as it were, then you get a slightly different picture. I totally concur also with this concern around the seabed. I mean, that's the foundation for a sustainable ecosystem, which in turn is obviously the foundation for a sustainable fishery. And so when we are having a benthic indicators, which are failing to meet good environmental status, that's a fundamental problem for recovery of stocks and for the essentially the resilience of the fishery itself, which is what certainly is driving SIFT. There is evidence, but we really need to look at it in close detail, and rather than some of the sort of banner headlines, which may not perhaps kind of portray the full picture.
Thank you, Charles. Yeah, I think that certainly hits on a point. The headlines don't always tell the full picture. Can I ask either Katie or Cathy of Nature Scot how they see inshore fisheries groups and NGOs working together to ensure we do get the right picture of what's happening in our seas? Katie?
Thank you very much for inviting us to speak today. It's really good to have that opportunity. Nature Scot has been involved with working with some of the inshore fisheries groups right since the start, I guess, of when they were set up, and continue to be involved through the regional inshore fisheries groups. I think there's been a kind of a gradual development in that as a stakeholder engagement mechanism, and we'd be really supportive of seeing that develop further into the future. I guess we don't have a really fixed view in terms of how that development should happen. But the key things for us are that whatever mechanism is used, it provides a meaningful mechanism for, you know, a really good exchange of ideas and opinions, and actually supporting future management going forwards, so that you get the full range of stakeholders involved in that. You didn't mention local communities there, but I think that's also an important part of what happens at a regional or local scale in fisheries management in the future.
Thank you. I'm going to stick with this topic on climate and ecological crisis and move to Alistair and then Mercedes for their questions.
Thank you, Convener. Much of what's been talked about so far has been, especially in the last panel, has been about the necessary trade-off between the future of the environment and the future of sometimes quite fragile rural economies. So can I ask, this is possibly a question for Charles, I'm not sure, of the areas which are currently actively fished, and as we've talked about, those areas are a minority of the Scotland seas, of the areas which are currently actively fished, what kind of change do you expect, or do you believe that these communities should expect in the coming years?
Oh, thank you. I think one of the questions, just if I can sort of as a preamble to that, is around some of the statements about what areas are currently actively fished. And one of the concerns that we have is that there is very little in the way of comprehensive data on that, because there is not a comprehensive coverage of the fleet in terms of their vessel monitoring and REM, remote electronic monitoring. Not entirely clear which areas are actually fished. And so that presents a first problem in kind of answering your question, Dr. Allen. But if I can perhaps then turn to some of the trade-offs around that have been referred to as well. I mean, I think the concern we have in my organisation is that there aren't necessarily trade-offs in all situations. I mean, what you can have is an ecosystem-based management approach, which will involve the use of spatial management. Indeed, as the fishery management strategy document published last year noted, MPAs can support fish stock recovery. And so what we're saying is that actually ecosystem recovery should be compatible in many cases with fishery recovery and the long-term sustainability of fishery. And so my concern there is that there is a sort of this siloization going on, that you have the ecosystem on one side and you have the fishery on the other. And we would say that the two are intimately linked. And if we can get that sort of past that that potential sort of the way that's viewed, then we are perhaps looking at a better route towards communities being actually able to work much more effectively together.
Thank you. Could Cathy address that, and then Callum, please?
Thank you, convener, and thanks for the opportunity to speak. Just building on what Charles said there, I mean, we support those comments about the need to avoid seeing this as a kind of either or, because, you know, comments that have been made earlier about recovering the health of the seas does offer huge benefits for long-term sustainability of the sector as well. But I also think that perhaps it's worth bringing in here the need for robust marine planning to help with these kind of, you know, these management of trade-offs. So we need marine plans to be able to prioritise and steer the use of marine space. And as we've said in the earlier session, our seas are getting much busier. And I think we need a revision of our national marine plan to manage those growing pressures and reflect the new priorities for climate and nature. And part of that is about better integrating fisheries management into those plans, both at the national level and at the regional level, so that we can achieve an appropriate balance. I think that's part of it, and, you know, allowing communities to have an input into the vision for their local seas will be an important part of that process.
Okay, thank you. And Callum.
Yeah, thank you, convener. Yeah, I just wanted to emphasise support for what both Charles and Cathy had said there. You know, using the phrase trade-off, you know, implies, you know, winners and losers. You know, as we go forward, there are decisions to be made, and it's not, you know, fair to suggest nothing can change and everybody, you know, can still continue as they are. I mean, changes have to happen, but it's about a process that brings everybody along with that. You know, marine planning is a very important part of that. I think integrating fisheries management with marine planning is really important, because, you know, all coastal communities and stakeholders have a stake in the health of the marine space that is a public good. And, you know, it's also important for the committee to understand that there's, you know, the talking about capture fisheries themselves. I mean, that's a complex and diverse sector, and there's parts of the sector that, for example, don't think some of the proposals in the programme for government, you know, go far enough. So there's a huge range of views there, and it's really important to have that, you know, open, forward-looking, inclusive, you know, dialogue with a shared evidence base, and, you know, a path and a vision of where to get to, and that would be really, really important.
Okay, Alistair.
If the panel don't like the word or the phrase trade-off, I'm happy to use another one like interface or cooperation. I think you can see what I'm driving at, which is really just how we manage that relationship. I absolutely accept, incidentally, what's been said about the need for change and what Charles said about things like the need for Winch monitors to provide data. I suppose what I'm driving at is that when we're talking about designations, do people on the Parliament, Elspeth touched on this, feel that there might be a better way of managing A, the process of designation to avoid confrontation, as has happened in some places, and also more that we can do to move on the process of community involvement in the management of designations? I'm not making a case against designation per se, just interested to know if you feel there's better ways of doing it.
Would anybody like to take that on? It's maybe one for Katie.
Thank you, yes. Well, I was really encouraged to hear the comments that Elspeth MacDonald was making in the previous session about the experience of working on the previous process of designating the Nature Conservation Marine Protected Areas. And I think the things that Elspeth was mentioning there around the need to have transparency and the need to make sure that we're working with a good evidence base and also the need for collaboration there, whatever phrase you want to use to describe that, whether that's, you know, co-production, full stakeholder engagement, but there needs to be a clearly established process. I think one of the things that we had as a benefit from the Nature Conservation MPA work is that there was that clear process set out, and I think there's a need to kind of take stock with the commitments that have come through now from the cooperation agreement and from the Programme for Government to clearly articulate things like, for example, what the highly protected marine areas might mean in Scotland, what the definition is, how they might work in practice, so that we can then engage with stakeholders and set out a clear process for how they're going to be selected and what it will look like when they're actually put into place. So I think I agree with a lot of the things that other people have said previously, and core to a lot of this is allowing the time and space in the process to actually enable all of the key stakeholders to have a role and to actually make sure they have their views heard. I would hope as well that there's also some opportunities that we could look at. There were mentions in the previous session about the future fisheries management strategy and how that related to the marine protection and commitments, and there are some obvious things that you might be able to pull out from both, for example, the need to protect spawning grounds and the need to protect nursery habitats. But it would be really good to, as we go through this process, to hear from both the fisheries and aquaculture industry about what they think the key opportunities they can see from implementing these commitments, so that we're actually, you know, responding to that need to restore and allow marine ecosystems to recover, but doing it in a way that achieves that balance and supports the longer term sustainability of their industries as well.
Thank you. And Callum would like to come back in.
Thank you, Convener. I support everything Katie said there, and to come back on the point about designations and concerns that may exist around them. I think the Scottish MPA process was, I mean, nothing's perfect, but it was deemed to be an excellent process, and Scottish Government and Nature Scotland, JNCC, and all stakeholders involved, I think, to be commended on that. The issue, if I may put it that way, you know, almost was happening in a silo, because there wasn't a fisheries strategy that it could be seen to be integrated with or interrelating with, or a planning system in which it was sitting. So it basically became, you know, and I was involved with a lot of the management workshops. They became sort of proxy discussions about what should be happening in the wider sea in terms of the use of that sea space, seabed use, you know, any displacement of gear might impact in other areas or other growing sectors, etc. So it's almost like you know, waiting for the wider fisheries management process processes and marine planning processes catch up. So I wanted to say that, to take the opportunity to respond to, you know, people's thinking about MPAs as means to sort of protect the remnants of some fragile bits of seabed, and that's not how we should be thinking about them. You know, the features that the MPAs protect, if allowed to recover, they interact and provide ecosystem services, whether it's locking up carbon, providing important habitat for commercial fish and shellfish, and providing, you know, resilient biodiverse systems themselves that are almost like a bank from which you know, you can replenish the wider sea. So, you know, it seems that the discussion about using closures, for want of a better term, curtailments of certain types of gear for the wider benefit of fisheries is, you know, it's quite a polarized discussion, because it's not been a proper framework or a space to have that discussion, from my perspective. So I think you wouldn't be surprised to hear that we welcome the commitment to highly protected marine areas. We think they can deliver benefit for biodiversity, for food provision, and for blue carbon, for planned right. And we do think it was the right thing to do to commit to capping effort and looking at how to kind of reduce effort on an evidence basis as well. So, obviously there's a lot to do, but I think a lot of the polarity and the tension arise as a result of kind of siloed processes and non-integrated processes, and it's and so just to finish, I would also support what Cathy was saying about the importance of a renewed national marine plan that doesn't pretend everything can grow and things won't interact or conflicts. And but for us, what's key is the baseline for the marine system is quite low, it's quite diminished, and we won't get the benefits for other parts of society.
Okay, Callum, I don't know whether you've stopped or whether your video is cut out. I'm just going to move on to Mercedes, but before then, can I ask either Katie or Cathy, we heard in the last session in the Environment Committee about the good work that was done up in Shetland between fishermen, NGOs, environmental groups, and the University of Heriot-Watt, I think it was. I'm looking for acknowledgement of that. I think it was. And there was a fantastic level of trust built up where the fishermen were happy to share their data and whatever. Is there other examples of good collaborative working like that that Nature Scotland and Marine Scotland can build upon to ensure that's replicated right across our coasts? Katie.
Thank you. Yes, Cathy might want to come in after this as well. I think there are lots of really good examples. I think there's an assumption that there hasn't been lots of good collaborative working going on to date. But there are lots of examples where there have been collaborations, whether that's between Nature Scots and industry, or between various different NGO groups and industry as well. So there are definitely lots of good examples, and I could mention a couple, but we'll also be happy to provide more information on these afterwards if that would be helpful to the committee. One example that springs to mind in terms of the kind of regional approach to fisheries management is obviously the Shetland Shellfish Management Organisation. And that's been, you know, a very different way to the approach that's been used in other parts of Scotland to managing what's happening with shellfish fisheries. So I would say that's one example where there's a whole range of different interests that have been brought together through a statutory mechanism to bring that regional tier of management in Scotland. So that's been really useful. I'd say as another completely different example, we've had the recent example of the Scottish Entanglement Alliance, which was a collaboration between industry and ourselves and NGOs and others as well, to actually look at potential issues, to see whether there are issues in terms of the entanglement of large marine animals with static fishing gear, and then to identify the kind of next steps and what could be done. So I definitely think that, you know, collaborative projects are the way to go forward, and, you know, would welcome kind of ideas and suggestions from others, and particularly from industry members about how we do that in future.
Thank you. And was Cathy want to comment?
No, I think Katie's covered that. Let's move on for the benefit of time.
Okay, thank you. Can I move on to Mercedes, please?
Thanks, Convener. I've got two questions relating to fishing management.
So the marine protected areas were designated in 2014, and I believe Nature Scott gave advice about fishing management in 2013, which included stating that dredging and trawling ought to be banned in several MPAs. But there are still many MPAs where these activities are continuing unrestricted. So my question for the Nature Scott representatives is whether they're concerned that Nature Scott's advice hasn't been heeded. And then the second question is for the whole panel, to ask what you think we can do to ensure that similar mistakes aren't made in the creation of the new future fishing management strategy.
Katie, I think it's probably appropriate to come in on that.
Thank you very much. You're right that we provided advice on the management of fishing activity in relation to MPAs. Just to give a little bit of background of our role in that process, is that we're not fisheries managers, obviously, and we leave that work to others to implement. Our role is to provide advice on the sensitivity of different habitats and species, and therefore to help fisheries managers to identify where the risks could be and therefore where management measures need to be put in place. So the work that's gone on to date in terms of management of fishing activity for MPAs focus on the first phase, which was for the most sensitive habitats and species. And so those are things that have been sort of more in the press recently. So things like seagrass beds and marl beds, so the most sensitive habitats and species. And the measures for those were all put in place a number of years ago. You're right that we also provided further advice on other habitats where further management would be required. And those were essentially mainly habitats and species that were of considered to be a moderate sensitivity. And so the questions were not so straightforward in terms of whether there should be fishing activity or not. So, if you have fishing activity that happens across a horse mussel bed or a seagrass bed, you can see very immediately what the impact of that would be. For the habitats that are still to have fisheries measures put in place, they're of a more moderate sensitivity. So very important habitats like burrowed mud, for example, where it's more to do with the amount of fishing effort. And so the kind of reducing the effort to a level that actually allows the habitat to be in a good condition. Rather than saying that there should be no fishing activity happening within those. So, we're aware that advice has been considered carefully by people in Marine Scotland, and we really welcome the commitment that's come through the cooperation agreement now to put clear timescales on that we're working towards. So we're aware also there's been a number of other pieces of work going alongside that. So ourselves and Marine Scotland Science and others have continued to develop the evidence base so that's stronger to support the management measures when they come through as proposals. And alongside looking at increasing the evidence base, there's also been work which is responding to stakeholder comments about how to develop better methods to actually assess the impacts or the benefits of any of the measures that are proposed, because that was feedback that we got from stakeholders previously that those methods that were being used didn't really capture that in quite that way. So I guess that's my answer to the first part of the question. We do feel that our advice has been listened to and that the commitment in the cooperation agreement sort of reinforces the commitment to act on that. And I guess the second question was about making sure that no other similar mistakes are made in the implementation of the future fisheries management strategy. I guess in terms of the future fisheries management strategy, it's very early days since 2020, my understanding is that the timescales for that and the planning is well underway for how that will be implemented. I think where kind of I interact with that work, or where the work of my team interacts with that, is really, I think, as an opportunity to look across from what's come through from the Programme for Government commitments and to look at the future fisheries management and see where the opportunities are, because I think there are read across between the two. And it would be really nice to actually, I guess, going back to part of what Callum was saying there, how do we join this all together into a bigger picture so that we're not just going to stakeholders and talking about, you know, highly protected marine areas one day and a cap on inshore fishing effort another day, and another time talking about how do we protect spawning areas, but we're actually presenting a picture that's in the round, and people can see that we're working towards something slightly bigger.
Thank you. Charles, would you like to come on in on that?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, in terms of ensuring mistakes not repeated, I mean, I think one of the fundamental issues, and it touches on what we've discussed just a moment before, on the whole question of engagement amongst different stakeholders. And I think really what the issue here is around governance and around the structures and how transparent they are so that different stakeholders can engage with one another. And I think, you know, if we've got a more transparent, more equitable system of engagement between different parties, clearly the fishing industry, but also the many others who also have a right to make use of the public asset that is our seas, then there needs to be some considerable thought given to how these governance structures work. And specifically with regards to the fishery management strategy, it talks about strengthening the role of the regional IFGs. Now, that some stakeholders is a cause for concern. The RIFGs are really exclusively for the fishing industry, and that's a it's fine to have a fishing industry body, but that seemed to be suggesting that the RIFGs were going to be taking a perhaps more dominant role in this. And so rather than broadening out the decision-making process to all stakeholders, which would ultimately presumably improve transparency and hence decision-making, seemed to be that Marine Scotland policy was pushing slightly in the opposite direction on this. Now, that is obviously a cause for concern, and I think that's something that really would be valuable to look at.
Okay, thank you. Would anybody else like to continue on that topic? Nope. Okay, can I move on to Beatrice for our questions, please?
Thanks, Convener. I was pleased, Katie, to hear you reference the Shetland Shellfish Management Order as a good example of collaborative working and also of local management. I think it was Callum that referenced the seabirds and seals that can get caught up in fishing gear. I mean, gill net fishing, I think we've all seen pictures on social media of seabirds that have been caught in gill nets. I'd like to ask questions about the future catching policy, and I asked earlier on the previous panel about the ICES scientific evidence on North Sea cod. So I wonder if I could get your views about how to reduce unnecessary discards and bycatch. Having heard that you know, you have a scenario where small whiting are being taken out of the mouths of a cod and being gutted while the cod is thrown over the side. So I think I'd like a little bit from our panellists about their views on future catching policy.
Who would like to start on that one? Charles again.
I mean, I should preface that with saying, of course, that North Sea catches are sort of out with the remit of Sustainable Inshore Fishery Trust. But I mean, I think I've got a broader general point on this, which is that there's a lot of the policy work is really says the right things, and my concern is perhaps about not so much whether the policy or the strategy or some of the framework statements are saying the right thing, but it's more a question of how the implementation goes ahead. And so, sorry to answer this in a sort of more broad way, but I think it's quite a critical point to make in this, that we need to, again, it's about drilling down into the detail. You know, something might sound quite encouraging, and you know, the UK Fisheries Act has some, you know, important objectives in there about climate change and things like that. But it's how it's going to be dealt with in practice. And I think this is perhaps something that is sort of broader in the time available, sort of feeling I need to get across at this stage. That helps.
Okay, thanks, Charles. Callum, please.
Yeah, thank you for the question. Lots of big topics, not a lot of time, but I think it's a very good question, and it comes down to information, sound science, evidence, confidence. I know we heard earlier about the differing perspective on quantities and so on. I mean, our perspective is we want to see remote electronic monitoring as a cost-effective means to get as much information as possible as to what is being caught where, whether it's caught or anything else. And that's a combination of cameras, suitably positioned, so they're not interfering obviously with they're only monitoring what's coming onto the boat and not the sort of the boat as a place of living, combined with GIS and other information. So we just build up a much better picture of what the state of the stocks are in order to inform future catching policy. We can provide, I have provided to predecessor committees a report on REM. I can do that again if need be. I'd also just quickly like to say one thing in the context of COD. It kind of gets to the point of ecosystem-based management as well. I know it wasn't much loved, but the COD recovery plan seemed to have been successful, and a part of that was the Windsock closure west of Shetland and Orkney, and they were finding cod catch within that from scientific surveys in the closure 78% higher than outside, and this site was also co-terminus with a marine protected area, and then the marine protected area is designated. But then the sunset clause, if you like, on the closure came into effect, and a new voluntary arrangement was put in place that actually allowed more of that area to be trawled. I welcome the fact that there was a voluntary arrangement in place to leave some alone, to have some for trawling and some for static. But it was quite an interesting example of, where not realising, I feel, the sort of ecosystem benefit of a closure around which they also happen to make an MPA. Because the fishing effort there is higher now it's an MPA than it was as part of a fisheries management measure. So we need to be looking at temporal and permanent closures that can help stocks recover. And I think the Windsock provided some evidence of the benefits to species that are commercial species, larger and wide-ranging species, but that can still be benefit from fixed close areas, because that closure was also seeing higher numbers of very fragile, low-growing, long-lived species, like some elasmobranchs, for example. So
thanks, Callum.
We need evidence, and we need ecosystem-based.
Thank you. Cathy, would you like to make a comment on this?
Yeah, thank you. Just briefly to add to what's been said, I think a lot of this really relates to the management of the fishery itself and the interaction between different stocks. But we would also want to think about broadening this discussion out a bit to, for example, the catching policy for populations of forage fish that are important within natural food chains, thinking about the importance of those elements, how you set sustainable levels to ensure that those issues are part of the picture, and also about, for example, in addition to bycatch of fish, looking at reducing unintended wildlife bycatch in fishing gear, and the work that Katie mentioned earlier about entanglement is perhaps part of that. So there are these sort of wider wildlife interactions that need to be considered within these discussions on the catching policy.
Thank you very much. Can we now move on to the environmental impact of aquaculture and other regulations? Karen, can I come to you, and then Ariane, please?
Thank you. Thank you, convener. You know, there's been much research and real potential for seaweed farming, particularly here in the northeast coast. It's really, you know, it's quite a tremendous opportunity for coastal communities to diversify into a new sector. And it's just one example of diversification, but clearly seaweed production is growing across the world and has been used and an extensive range of products, eco-products, and also absorbs a significant amount of CO2, so it can also contribute to net zero. So what I'd like to ask the panel really is, what has been asked of the fishing community in relation to this diversification in the context of the sustainable marine environment? Because we now see regulation of these newly expanding areas being conferred on. And what other possible diversification can you see coming to the fore that you feel is eco-friendly but also economically positive for struggling coastal communities?
Thank you, Karen.
Thank you.
Katie, would you like to address that in the first instance, please?
Thank you. I'll leave this one to Cathy, I think.
Right. Okay.
Thank you. Yeah, good question. And there's a lot in that. I think in terms of things like new industries, like seaweed cultivation, there is a lot of potential there. But it is something where we need to make sure that the regulatory framework and the evidence base there is available to make sure that we're making good decisions on, you know, locations for these new activities, to make sure that they're not damaging anything that we, you know, that's already there in terms of natural features, and that we understand how to harvest sustainably. For example, you know, some of the past discussion has been on harvesting of wild seaweed. Seaweed, particularly things like kelp beds, play a really important role in the functioning of ecosystems, things like providing coastal defences to coastal communities. It's really important that we don't, you know, embark on new developments and exploitation without understanding sustainability of those practices. So cultivation, I think about getting the locations right, about getting the management right, and, you know, thinking about things like biosecurity as well is important. So lots of factors we need to consider. Whether that's something that, you know, the fishing sector might want to diversify into, certainly worth looking at. There was a report done on wild harvesting and, you know, diversification for the fishing sector. And there were some opportunities sort of identified there in terms of small scale, I think, seaweed harvesting that might be worth investigating. There are potentially other sort of opportunities along the lines of wildlife tourism that can be sustainably developed within coastal economies. So I think there is more work to do on this. And, you know, as part of a consideration of just transition, we definitely need to be helping and thinking about what those opportunities might be as we kind of grow more diverse and sustainable coastal economies going forward.
Thank you. Charles, would you like to come in on that?
Yeah, certainly. And I endorse a lot of what Cathy's just said. I think that seaweed industry presents a really excellent opportunity for coastal economy diversification. It does also need a new regulatory, or indeed a regulatory framework, and Cathy referred to biosecurity policies and certainly guidance on the siting of farms. I think that's very important. But other issues around prohibition of artificial enrichment or pesticides, these all need to be looked at. To ensure that it's done in a way which means that it can coexist with fishing industry and other stakeholders. One particular concern we have is the scale of the of potential seaweed farms. Now, what's been applied for and starting to be developed out recently, we've all been relatively small, up to 50 hectares, I think, is sort of about the largest at the moment. but there is talk of them going much larger, and certainly elsewhere around the world, these are very large-scale, multi-hundred-hectare sites. This is a potentially important issue for the inshore economy. It needs to be managed properly. CO2 benefits are certainly potentially there. Of course, actually, the CO2 sequestrated by kelp, and be it natural or be it cultivated, really depends on what happens to the kelp after it's been harvested. So there are issues around that too. But it's welcome, but it's got to be managed. When you're looking at small sea lochs, you don't want very large seaweed farms in them. Other activities which could potentially provide opportunities for diversification, certainly, I mean, it's been discussed earlier today around shellfish farming. It's small scale at the moment, the mussel farming industry. It's got issues around getting adequate scale from individual sites to be able to compete in large markets. So there's assistance perhaps needed there. Oyster reintroductions on a commercial level, as well as for carbon sequestration reasons. There are a number of opportunities here which I think really need to be looked at. And as has been mentioned before, the need for a kind of planning regime, a marine planning regime, is sort of becoming all the more apparent as these different activities emerge to try and identify how they can coexist so that they don't displace fishing and that they don't displace other activities. So these are all issues which are extremely important and need to be looked at. As I say, so I would definitely include shellfish and, in this list, if you like.
Thank you. Can I ask Ariane for her questions, then we'll have a supplementary from Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. A couple of things. One is, I'd be curious to hear from the panel your thoughts on, you know, other stakeholders, community groups, tourism businesses, you know, people whose livelihoods depend on marine biodiversity, joining these regional inshore fisheries group meetings. And that, you know, you were touched upon that earlier, you know, that it's limited, and just curious to hear about that, opening that up. And then on the regulation, going back to the regulation part, environmental impacts around salmon farming, I'd be curious to hear your views on further regulation for that specific sector of aquaculture.
That's probably one for Katie or Cathy to kick off on the other groups on the inshore fisheries to begin with. Thanks.
Thanks very much. Maybe if I take the points about the inshore fishing groups and then pass over to Cathy on the environmental impact of aquaculture. I touched on this just a bit earlier in relation to the role that local communities and others might play in that. Maybe it's a slightly disappointing answer, but we don't have a fixed view on what the mechanism should be. But I guess we do have a strong view that we need to be really clear about who all the stakeholders are, that we want to have a voice in fisheries management going forward. And there are a lot of stakeholders who are well engaged with fisheries management processes, but we're aware, obviously, that there are other stakeholders who feel that they maybe haven't had that opportunity. So I think having a discussion about kind of who is involved in those discussions and being really clear about that and getting that agreed will then help the regional inshore fisheries groups or whatever other mechanism is used to then take those next steps to developing into the future. And I guess there's a question related to that about to what extent is that a kind of a stakeholder engagement facilitation mechanism, or to what extent is that a mechanism that provides for the kind of co-design, kind of co-management approaches, and really needed to think through the governance to support that.
Thank you. And Cathy?
I'll pass over to Cathy now.
Yeah, thank you. I'll come in on the aquaculture part of the question. We welcome the Programme for Government commitment to a new vision and strategy for aquaculture. And we're also already engaged in the Professor Griggs regulatory review, which was mentioned earlier. Key points that we've been feeding into that regulatory review are that at the moment we've got quite a kind of tangled system of different consenting regimes, and in particular we've got the interface between planning consent and licensing under CEPA's licensing process, and also marine licensing. And I think one of the key things is that aquaculture is not well suited to a one-off planning consent type arrangement. It is an ongoing process, you know, it's a management system within the marine environment, and it really then is better suited to a licensing regime which could be more easily adapted as things happen and change, and that monitoring can then feed back into changes to the kind of way the license operates. So that's a really important part, I think, that needs to be considered, because at the moment we're trying to shoehorn things into the planning framework when it's really not very suited to that. So hopefully that can be looked at. I think there's another point about the alignment of the different regulatory regimes and things like environmental impact assessment and how we bring that together a bit more successfully. And I'm trying to kind of link up the way that all the different regulators sort of feed into the early discussions with developers about new sites to make sure that we really influence the kind of siting and the location in the best way, so we avoid big challenges further down the line. And part of that is about the spatial planning framework for aquaculture and making sure that we've got good maps to show where more suitable locations are actually located, so that developers can steer towards those. There's a lot going on elsewhere in relation to work on things like interaction with wild salmonids and sea lice risk framework, work on acoustic deterrent devices, and things that we're talking to industry about on seabed impacts, sensitive features, priority marine features that we talked about earlier, and things like entanglement of seabirds in nets. And these are all really important strands of work. And I think it's just critical that when we design perhaps a better regulatory framework, we make sure that those sort of new approaches to tackle some of those environmental challenges are properly embedded within the regulatory framework, so that we're not making it complicated with additional requirements. It's all sort of integrated into one system. But I think there's a lot going on, and hopefully at the end of this process, we will have a much stronger, better system of regulation. As Tavish mentioned earlier, it's not about changing things completely. It's about just having better regulation that does the job more effectively.
Thank you. We've got a small supplementary from Rachel, and then we'll move to Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. It's a question on that to Cathy, please. The licensing and the planning, obviously, if you're looking at that, will the licensing, you've mentioned the environmental impact that you will take into account, will that also take into account the potential location with regards to jobs and local economy?
So I think for a new development coming in, there will always need to be some form of, one-off new development type planning process to cover those aspects and the wider impacts in terms of how things fit into a coastal community. So I'm not really suggesting that we don't have some form of spatial linkage through a system like the planning system to allow the social license, the community views to be taken into account to work out how it fits with other infrastructure. It's more about the other parts of managing an aquaculture operation which are currently being sort of shoehorned into planning through the use of things like environment management plans, but probably sit much better with an ongoing licensing process. So I think that all needs to be worked through in the regulatory review, but you're right, there are some elements that probably still need to sit and have some input from local community input and other stakeholders as well.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. It's just a quick question, maybe directed at Callum, about marine litter. Callum presented to the Marine Tourism Cross-Party Group at the end of the last parliamentary session, and I'm a member of that CPG, and you talked about work that was being done to look at dealing with marine litter. So I'm just wondering about an update to that. Is there work being done to connect and collaborate with fishermen and inshore fishermen on how to deal with marine litter? I know that one of the fishermen in Kirkcudbright has been doing a good job of securing what needs to be secured on his boat so that things don't fly over the side, for instance. So I'm just seeking a wee update about that.
Hey, Callum.
Okay, thank you. We've been happy to collaborate. We did a big cleanup at Cairnbolg, I think it was, with Chemo and SFF locally, but in terms of sort of more widely and more strategically, you know, the fishing for litter team continues and expands, and we're obviously supportive of that. The marine litter strategy steering group has the issue on its agenda, and they also commissioned the Marine Scotland commissioned Resources Futures to take a real close look at actually litter deriving from the fishing industry itself. So there's obviously the two things, you know, fishing for litters, where participating skippers are you know, helpfully bringing what they bring up in their nets back ashore, and then there's also dealing with the sort of some of which might be direct litter from the industry, or some much of it might not be. But then there's also the issue of, you know, better dealing with the, you know, the waste generated on the vessels themselves. So you know, I can provide a report to you afterwards that Resources Futures have done for Marine Scotland that was looking at and made a number of recommendations, which I'd be happy to share with you. You know, chiefly it's about making it easier for vessels of all kinds, including fishing vessels, to be able to get their rubbish ashore and for it then to be properly dealt with. And obviously, you know, that'll depend on the scale of facility that they're returning to in terms of port or quayside or what have you, and it won't be one size fits all. But sorry, that's a bit general. I don't have specifics, but I can get that report to you after the meeting.
Thank you, Callum. That would be useful. And finally, we've got a question on budgets from Rachel Hamilton.
Nature Scots website states that the Scottish Marine Enhancement Fund will be launched imminently, and I just wondered if you did have a date that you could give us on when that will be launched, and can you outline where the budget for that money is coming from, how it will operate, and will the funding be conditional in the way that the future of funds are happening within the programme for government?
Cathy.
Yeah, thank you. So the idea for the Scottish Marine Environmental Enhancement Fund is to encourage all those who use our marine environment to invest in its long-term health and sustainability. So the fund will actually be made up primarily of voluntary contributions from different sectors and different users and just anyone else who wants to make a contribution. And then it will, using a sort of series of criteria, award grants to projects that are intended to promote enhancement or also to targeted research to enhance the evidence base on things like restoration in the marine environment. The plan is not that, you know, that this will be government funding necessarily, although things like the Nature Restoration Fund you know, might be one part of the money that is dispersed through this mechanism going forward. But the bigger pot of money we hope will come from users of the marine environment. And that's already been the case in terms of offshore wind sector in particular, being a sort of early contributor to the fund. They've sort of helped to get this started, get this off the ground. But we're now talking to a much wider range of sectors who are all interested in contributing and getting involved as well. You know, we're about to launch the kind of fundraising element of SMEEF. SMEEF is being sort of driven by Marine Scotland Directorate within Scottish Government, Crown Estate Scotland and ourselves. And we've had very strong ministerial support for setting up the fund. It will be hosted initially within Nature Scot. And as I say, yeah, I can't give you an actual date, but over the next within the next month or two, we will be launching a sort of fundraising drive for SMEEF, putting it on a slightly more official basis, and then hopefully opening to applications for the fund in the spring next year. So I hope that answers all the elements of your question, but come back to me if not.
Can I just open up to the rest of the panel with regards to any future funding gaps that might appear as we move towards a just transition? I just wondered how the fishing and aquaculture industry themselves play a part in shaping some of these funds? I don't really know who to...
Can I maybe just ask Charles to briefly comment on that, because we are running out of time.
I feel that's slightly beyond my remit, with apologies, actually. That's not an issue. We are a modestly funded, modest-sized NGO. That's not really an issue, that specific one, which I feel I can adequately comment on.
Can I open it up to the rest of the panel, please?
I'm not sure that the question's maybe right for Callum or Charles on basing that comment. So it may be for... And I'm not sure that our... Oh, Cathy's going to respond.
I can come in back in again, if you like. I mean, in terms of the involvement of the fishing and aquaculture sectors in the discussions about the SMEEF fund, we have reached out to those sectors, but recognise that they've obviously had quite a lot of issues with COVID and EU exit. And so there's been no sort of pressure put on them to kind of formally engage. But we hope that, you know, as things get easier, that they will be able to kind of engage more with that process and be part of that sort of growing movement in relation to SMEEF. In relation to kind of wider funding, we mentioned the Nature Restoration Fund, which is... it has been a sort of programme for government commitment. It's obviously going to be carried forward. A point was made earlier about the kind of one-year funding issues. And you know, I think there is an issue there about trying to move beyond that to multi-year project funding so that we can plan ahead. And some of these sorts of projects take much longer than 1 year to develop and to come to fruition. And they need funds to be able to support project development and staffing costs, as well as just you know, the capital costs of carrying out the work. So I think there's ways that we can look at how Marine Fund Scotland evolves to be able to support some of these priorities as well, alongside the sort of just transition, as well as supporting climate and nature priorities. And then there's something about research and innovation and how we make sure that we're properly joined up, particularly in relation to the fishing and the aquaculture sectors, to try to fund the kind of research and innovation that we need to overcome the sort of ongoing environmental challenges and the new things that are coming up as well. We've got some good mechanisms in terms of Fisheries Innovation Scotland and the Aquaculture Innovation Centre, but I think we could probably do more to be strategic about how we identify the kind of priority gaps and the innovation needs, and develop joint projects with industry to address those.
Thank you very much. And Jenny Minto has a question on post-exit fisheries governance to close the session.
Hi, and I think this is directed to Katie. I asked the last panel about the new legislation that was brought in as a result of leaving the EU, so I'd be interested to know what your views are on the objectives within the Fisheries Act 2020 and priorities within the development of the joint fisheries statements and fishery management plans under the Fisheries Act. Thanks.
Thank you. I'll keep this brief, but we can always provide more follow-up afterwards, but just because of time. I mean, I think broadly we welcome the objectives that have come through from the Fisheries Act and the definitions that have been published alongside of those. I think that's really helpful for then moving on to implementing it. I think others have mentioned it before, but in terms of our priorities for future fisheries management, it's about making sure that we have an ecosystem-based approach. And those objectives speak to that, and we welcome, you know, the elements of the ecosystem-based approach that have been brought into the future fisheries management strategy, things that I've mentioned before, like the nursery and spawning grounds, for example. But I think one of the things that Elspeth MacDonald mentioned before was in the earlier discussion, how we think about how we link up through the marine protection policies and the future fisheries management strategy to kind of streamline that whole process will be really, really useful. In terms of the joint fisheries statement, I think the only thing I'll say on that just now is that, you know, we recognise that's a really useful part of providing that overall context so that we understand what the processes are that will be used for kind of join up on fisheries management. And in terms of the fisheries management plans, if this is the route that Scotland goes down, then, you know, we see that plans like this do have a lot of potential to really implement those kind of objectives in a very structured way. But whether or not you know, fisheries management plans are what are used, I think we need to make sure that we have some kind of mechanism that facilitates an objective assessment of where particular fisheries are against an agreed set of criteria. And then that will help us to identify where the strengths and the weaknesses are in the management. And then in turn, that should help us to identify what the future priorities and actions are.
Thank you very much. And I would like to thank the panel for their patience, for the panel starting late and for running over time. So thank you very much again for your evidence, and no doubt we'll come back to you some time later in the session. We will now move into private session. Thank you.